Welcome to another episode of Through the Glass here in sunny Asbury Park. We're at Lake House Recording Studios, our gracious host for this show. Today I have Vero, excellent rapper and producer, an all-around good guy. Hope to get into a lot of interesting things with him today. Hello, Vero.
Hey, how's it going, Mike?
It's going good. See you, man. It's good to see you. I appreciate you coming on the show.
Yeah, happy to be here, man.
Really being cool. Open to the idea.
It's a great idea. Great name, too. Would the name come in your sleep or something? It's a brilliant name.
It didn't come in my sleep. It came as I was trying to figure out a way to do this show in a COVID-responsible, COVID-friendly manner. I was talking to my wife. I was like, yeah, we could just kind of shoot it through the glass.
Wow. Well, that's like an epiphany moment right there.
Kind of was. And then I just ran with it. I fell in love with this format. A couple of years ago, I was in Europe and had spent a lot of time on trains, so just downloaded a shitload of podcasts.
Oh, that's nice, huh?
And then I got hooked.
Joe Rogan?
That was probably one of the first podcasts I listened to. I think it was him with his first interview. I think he's done several with Neil deGrasse Tyson.
All awesome. He's a man, right? His stuff is great.
It's funny. I read him when I was younger. I have one or two books of his that maybe I got when I was a teenager, and I'm 1,000 years old now. So it was some of his earlier books. I just didn't connect the writer. It was just a name on the front of the book. With now, he's like a pop.
Yeah, he kind of is. Like, he is a pop icon, and yeah, it has changed. I guess everyone is really a pop icon now. Like in the age of the internet.
Well, it's funny. It's cool to see an astrophysicist be so hip and cool. But yeah, I was reading him when I was younger. I've always been a geek with science. That's why I married a scientist.
Yeah.
So that was one of the first ones I heard. I was on a train and listened to 3 hours of him breaking down the universe for us mere mortals
And last week, we're on Mars, right? I guess it would be this week, actually.
Maybe 2-3 days ago. Yeah, it was. My sister-in-law got us hip to it. She's like, "Hey, you should turn on NASA's YouTube channel." Was streaming live, so I put the kids in the living room, and they were checking it out, and they thought it was really cool.
That's something, man.
They're gonna see some of those first pictures. That photo was.
Oh,
sweet.
I saw a video too, a 360 video.
Oh, I didn't see that yet.
Yeah, Elon Musk too. Like, talk about. Trailblazer.
This is on another level.
This is another level. Yeah, this is crazy.
Then there's dudes like me.
Come on, man. You always.
You brought a bottle of wine. Thank you for that.
Of course, man. Absolutely.
A Syrah from Napa Valley.
Yeah.
What's your connection with the Napa Valley again?
I enjoy the wine.
Well, it's great. You knew a grower.
Oh, yeah. So it's my dad's friend. He owns a vineyard, and he's always kind enough to send us some bottles to enjoy. And I know you're an enthusiast, and I think you'll definitely enjoy it.
I appreciate that.
Yeah,
thank
absolutely.
You. What's the name of the vineyard?
Krupp Family Vineyards.
All right, so check them out, folks. Yeah. Krupp Family Vineyards.
Yeah, really good stuff. They have a site. They do like gift boxes and stuff. It's tremendous, actually.
Have you been out to Northern California?
I wish. I know you have.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, right before we had kids, that was like our big, like, whoop, we're doing it, we're going big.
Big Sur, right, too?
We hit Big Sur, San Francisco, Mendocino County, Sonoma County, which in the wine world is, it's right next to Napa Valley, which is where your dad's friend's vineyard is, but that's a big wine growing industry.
Hmm.
And then we hit... I always mess up. Is it Yellowstone or Yosemite? What's the one in Northern California?
I would say maybe Yosemite.
Sure. We hit the national park. We went big. Stayed 3 days.
That sounds incredible.
In each spot. So hit like four or five spots, 2-3 days. In
House
each.
On the Cliff.
Dude. Big Sur is where it's at.
Yeah. Also with the Mac update too. They named their new Mac update Big Sur.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, they did. Funny, they have Yosemite, too. I guess it's always a trend to name it after landmarks.
Well, it's a California company.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Their headquarters is something. I heard something about their headquarters. It's not actually built on Earth. There's something, a foundation that's separating it from Earth, just in case of earthquake, the facility would be untouched. It's tremendous.
Well, we have a somewhat maybe less earthquake-friendly version of that right here in Lake House. So all the live rooms, the room that you're sitting in, as well as other spaces, they're really rooms within rooms. They're suspended on all sides, underneath, for soundproofing purposes. Yeah. And there's probably some more science about it that I don't understand.
Rooms, man. I love these rooms. Can't leave this place.
Well,
it's got my heart.
I dig your music, man. So for those who don't know Vero, check him out. I think if you're looking on Spotify, you got to add two O's. Do you not? V-E-R-O-O?
On Instagram, unfortunately. I have offered the person with at Vero $100 like every day just to like, she just doesn't respond.
Hey, at Vero. Hook him up.
Yeah, right.
Don't
right.
even take his money.
I wish. No,
he'll give you a bottle of wine. Yeah. Give up the name unless it's really important to you, because your music's really great. In particular, I like Sweet a lot. I think that's just a great track.
Thank
Afternoons,
you.
Die a King has a really good flow that I really like. It's just, it kind of rolls real nice. How did you get into music?
Man, that's like a big question. How did I get into music? I would have to say, in part, two people, my father and my brother. My father, like, when I was the littlest kid ever, like, the earliest memories of music I have is listening to the Supremes in the back of my dad's car at, like, an insane volume level. And my dad would always do this, like, funny dad joke. It would be, like, at an insane decibel level. He'll turn it down, look in the back seat, you go, "You hear it back there?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I think I hear it." And just from there, it kind of intrigued me. And then my brother was really the one that got me into rap. I remember those days vividly. He showed me Nas, I Can. Do you know that record?
Yeah, Nas is great.
Oh, my God. Like,
I just watched the documentary. I don't remember the name of it, but there's a really good documentary. I saw it on Prime. Amazon
Prime.
Is it
Nas' documentary? Or is it just, wow.
Yeah, it's great.
I'll definitely check that out. But yeah, I remember listening to that stuff and I was like, wow, this is like the most incredible thing I've ever heard. It's like, it just like, it was like a kismet meeting for me. It was just like the second I heard it, I was like, this is what I wanted. This is like, how do you do this? How is he like, he's like teaching, he's like doing melodies. It was just like so like, mind blowing to me. I was just like, wow, like, I want to do that. Like, I want to hit play on something I made and feel that same feeling. So I think that's always been the chase, you know.
What other artists was your brother listening to that turned you on?
Oh, man. That's like really early on, but I think like 50 Cent, like the whole Shady aftermath, 50 Cent, Eminem, Dr. Dre, that was like a crazy cool time. Then it was like Tribe Called Quest, like just really, really early on. And then Kanye West comes, and Kanye West changed my life, yeah. Oh, man.
When you write songs, are you thinking about those artists in any way, or do you feel like their influence is sort of just sunk in? When did it become your own thing? Because I don't hear... And I think this is a cool thing. I don't hear any of those artists
in
the music.
Yeah, I think I was just crediting them as being like the first people I heard and was just amazed by. I was just like, wow. Like, I remember when Kanye did the VMAs. I think it was 2010. Comes out in the red suit, NPC in the middle of the stage, does Runaway. That was it. That was the minute I became a producer. It was that show. After that, that was it. I was like, "Fuck, here we go. Now I have to be a producer." It was just so powerful to me. So moving.
I love the power of music in that respect.
Yeah.
And it doesn't even matter when it comes to you. There was an artist we had on recently who didn't get into music until like late high school. He said, which to me is astonishing, but it doesn't matter. When it hits you, it's heavy. And for a lot of us, you're in the tribe, as we call it here in the studio. Yeah. It means it's almost like a challenge. It's like, okay, what are you going to do now?
Yeah.
How are you going to apply this? What are you going to contribute? When did you start creating your own art and own music?
I'd say about 13. Like, I think 14, 15, I started, like, writing raps around then. And then I didn't start producing until that VMA show. That VMA show did it for me. That gave me a whole ton of headaches for the next year, trying to figure out, all right, how the hell does he do this? Because it was just like, and then like, even listening to the record, like My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy, I remember like playing that through in my car, like baked out of my mind, just like listening to it. And I was like moved to tears. I was like, how does this sound so fucking good? How could something be this good? Like, and since then, like, that was a very, very, there's always little moments, and you didn't know too, you're a great musician, you're a musician, and you know, there's little moments here and there that God sometimes just taps you on the shoulder, and it's like, wanted you to see this, wanted you to hear that, you know?
I do. I was really fortunate. My mother played guitar, and her group was always rehearsing at the house. So some of my earliest memories are in my PJs.
Wow.
You know, putting the guitar cases to the side, maybe, you know, maybe serving some tea. It's like a Christian folk group. There wasn't any partying going on. I mean, maybe someone had a caffeinated tea. It might have got a little wild. Maybe some lemon, maybe a rind.
Oh, man.
But so it was always there. And then, so I was very fortunate. There was never a time when it wasn't there, and always had guitars in the house. There was always musicians. Not always, but they would rehearse at the house. So that was like at least weekly.
So you grew up around it, though. You know,
grew up around it, man. It was great. And so I took it for granted probably for a long time. I didn't want to play guitar. I wanted to. I was a rambunctious, unfocused, still unfocused, generally.
Stop. Yeah.
So I just want to play drums.
I just got to say, look at what you created, man. This is awesome. Like, I've watched every episode, you know what I mean? And just like knowing you, you really are a trendsetter around here. I mean, I admire you in so many ways around here. It's, you know, especially this place. I can't leave this place, man.
This place has nothing to do with me. This is John Liedersdorf's vision and the high-level engineers who have implemented these things. I'm honored to manage it. You don't want me touching any of the buttons in this place, bro. It's like, I will fuck up your music in a bad way.
No, stop that. No. But yeah even John, like, even the second I met John, like, talk about again, like, an iconic to me. Like, he's just in the scene around here, and just, it just has an aura of just, like, greatness, you know what I mean? And, like, this studio represents that, and I feel like every time you're in here, you always brush up against something, like, something's here.
It makes you want to step up your game, too.
Makes you, hell yeah. That's the most important part, you know?
And that's how I met you, when I started managing the studio and how to just, you know, take over the business end of the place, the less cool aspect, the less interesting aspect of things.
One of the most important, though.
I think that's correct.
That is.
And, just getting to meet so many people, usually just through phone calls and all this, and that's how I met you. And then I started listening to your music, and I think you've got a great sound. So, you know, you had mentioned some rappers, but you've got your own thing going on. There's a sexiness, if I may, to your music, which I really like. So it's like, it's got this, like, I like to listen to your shit in the morning.
Oh yeah. Maybe this next album may be more of a nighttime album.
That would be great.
Yeah.
How did you, now, you collaborate with several people, but there's one producer in particular, Colin McCabe.
Mr. McCabe. The undeniable.
He's great. I love Colin. He does a good amount of work out of the studio, and he's great. How did you guys hook up?
Right here. You know what? My first sessions were with a kid named Dylan McLean. Did you get it?
No, I just know the name, but he was gone before I started.
Yeah, probably. He had moved to California to work with, forget who, one of those producers, nonetheless. And then I did another couple sessions, and I was kind of just looking for, you know, that spark or tandem or just like that click. And then John texted me. He was like, hey, man, got this kid Colin, like, totally come in for a session, you know, like, and then we came in, we worked, and I think we both got a feeling, like, that was, like, we were meant to meet, I think. I think God guided us a bit, our paths.
So how does it work? Tell our viewers, you know, people come from all different genres of music. In the rap and hip-hop world, what does the relationship look like between producers or between a rapper and a producer when it's at its best?
Yeah, that's true. So Colin is an engineer, first and foremost, and a tremendous one. Like, and it really works with just dynamic and just understanding and also points in life. You know, we were at, I think when we first even got in a session, we were at similar points. We were both like, man, we want to do something great, you know? We're here to take care of business, get downright funky, like, do something great. And I think more and more, we just kind of felt this kind of dynamic together, and things started really clicking. And I've learned so much from him too, man. He's like, he's a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant engineer. He, like, his ear is impeccable. It really is. It's something.
So how does the process work on a granular level?
So the process.
Who brings who what? How does it work?
Process works. He brings me tea. I take care of it. No. the process works. It's really us, me coming in a lot of times. It's me coming in with a record, with the beat and the song. And then we'll go through our whole, I like to say he goes through his old Rain Man and, like, starts hitting buttons, you know what I mean? And since then, I've learned what everything does. I've learned, okay, what the CL1B versus the LA2A will do, what the Neve 1073 will sound like. This is all because of him. I really had no knowledge of any of that. And, we kind of track, and then we do our thing. And my process has changed a lot, though. Like, it really hasn't stayed the same. And I don't know if that was a conscious decision or not. But a lot of times I would have the beat, have the record, all wrote, and I would come in and just do it. You know what I mean? Like most bands, like, I'm sure your experiences. But then you also have like impromptu kind of, like, or like just kind of on the go kind of sessions, and like things where, like, you come in without the idea and you're like, all right, I'm coming in and we're gonna see what happens, kind of. And those have a great meaning to the process of making music as well. So I think it was just me bouncing back and forth between those two things and learning what yields the best product.
Sometimes it's good to come in empty. Sometimes it's good to come in full. That's a good point. And it's cool when people can work both ways. I've always prided myself in being an artist like that. Coming into a session or just a jam, just writing. I'm cool if there's no plan, and let's just, hey, how was your day? And let's go off that.
Yeah.
Or like, hey, here's these 15 things I can't get out of my brain. I'm dreaming about them. They're making me insane.
That's true.
I got to flush this out. Cool.
That's the muse.
Let's do that.
That's the muse at work.
That is the muse
at work. Man, you ever watch TED Talks?
Yeah, I've seen many.
Do you ever happen to see one by a woman named Elizabeth Gilbert? It's Your Elusive Creative Genius, I think it's called. Man, talk about another thing that changed my life. That TED Talk changed my life. That's a high recommend for you. You'll really connect with that.
What's the title again?
It's by Elizabeth Gilbert. I think it's called Your Elusive Creative Genius. And to get into it, she basically goes into the idea of creativity, and she kind of sifts through history and sees all how each different society has interpreted creativity. And she does this kind of seminar about ancient Rome, ancient Greek. Now, in ancient Rome, ancient Greek, they thought about creativity in a very, very different way. There was this thing called a daemon, or a spirit that they believed in that would live in the walls and assist the artist as they were working. And the Romans called that a genius. That was the term for that. It was a genius. And with that kind of like construct, you have some separation as an artist. Because there's times where you come in and you don't get it done, and it's frustrating. But with that construct, you could say, all right, maybe the walls aren't talking tonight. You know what I mean? Like, and it creates the separation as an artist to not be hard on yourself if things don't if a session doesn't go well, or the song isn't coming to you, or if you played the same riff 8 million times and you can't get the words. Like, it's not necessarily your responsibility, almost, in a way. It absolves some pressure.
That's a great point. There was some heavy psychedelics in those cultures too. So the genius and the daemon might also have been the psychedelic.
So, but then here comes the Renaissance, and then we put the person at the center, and we, instead of calling this person has a genius, this person is a genius, which she said, huge error. Because what kind of pressure is that? You know what I mean? To think like that you are just the vessel of creativity, or you know what I mean? It really struck a chord with me, because I've brushed up on that thing a couple times. Like, I'm sure you have, where you're not really sure where the song came from. There's times I get songs and I feel like I had nothing to do with them at all. And it's a goosebump experience. And I know you've had the same, because every person has.
100%.
And whether that be in any kind of, it's not just music.
No, any
it's
art
a
form.
Chef, anything.
Any art form. Yes, chef, a sculptor, a photographer, a musician. Anything where you're creating something.
Yeah.
Oh, you're absolutely right. I like your I like how you mentioned how it takes the pressure off.
It does, because
we put too much pressure on ourselves, and I think artists in general, in my experience, I mean, we have issues.
See, the funniest thing though, that's basically why, like, that's another of her point, is there seems to be this connection between artists and suffering of some sort.
100%.
Which is, I think it's unfair. I don't think that's true.
It is unfair, but at the same time, if every artist was just lazy, let's be honest. You know?
It's not a laziness. See, like, if you show up, like, that's true. I'm showing up for my part.
What I mean. Not, like, if you even brush off, just not even showing up anymore. Like,
Then
you're expecting things to come to you. Yeah, you put yourself in the game, you show up, as you say. And yeah, taking the pressure off is tough. It's cool to think about it as an outside force.
Yeah, because it
force.
Gives this separation of saying, you know what, I'm fucking it, I'm showing up. You know, and if the song doesn't come, it's not necessarily my fault. I'm here. You know what I mean? If the thing doesn't want to brush up against me tonight, and then that's when the mechanical side of songwriting comes in, right? Because it's at the end of the day, a lot of what I've learned is this is a business, almost first and foremost. So when you can't rely always to just wait until that thing hits you. Sometimes you really have to grudge through stuff, you know what I mean?
Well, when you grind, it also, if we're going to keep with this metaphor of this outside force, it sharpens those receptors. The more you grind, the sharper your compass gets, tighter everything. Your doesn't mean it's going to come, but your ability to touch it, to see it, to recognize it in yourself or others, it sharpens that. And that's what a lot of people use. I mean marijuana.
Oh man.
Like for a creative process, it'll, you know, it means a million things to a million different people, but for many artists, a way to get in touch with the creative side, to put your ear against the wall, if we're going to keep with the with that idea, certainly doesn't always work when it comes time to get to the process of pounding those things out. But the initial dance and getting in touch with those things, highly effective, I think.
I mean, hell yeah. Oh yeah. I have smoked an ungodly amount of weed. Even in the past, whatever. I mean, talk about a crazy fucking time, man. This is just craziness. This is wild.
How you doing with it?
I think as good as everyone, you know. I miss being on the other side of the glass, you know what I mean? I love this, but... Yeah, you know, you miss the little things that you take for granted that came along with this, I think. I will say, though, I do believe this will all benefit us, because I think it's something we now share together. We've all been through this together, really, as a world. You know what I mean? And I think we share this, and through that we'll maybe create more unity and strength with us all.
I hope you're right. Because, struggle or discomfort or flip of the script, however you want to say it, it does bring people together.
Yeah.
Sure, it's an opportunity to divide, and I think there's a lot of forces in the world that benefit from division of people. But ultimately... we have so much in common. There's so much in common. And just to put a little more emphasis, a little more amplification and loudness on the things that we have in common is so healthy, because we're social animals.
Yeah.
The human species only survived because of being social. And yes,
absolutely,
you could argue that it got tribal and warring and all this, but ultimately the survival came from being social, from working together, finding shelter, finding food, making sure the babies stay alive to grow up and have more babies.
Also, nice footnote is something that someone brought to my attention, or I read on the internet. Spanish flu, 1918, I believe, right after Roaring Twenties. So hopefully we could be looking at maybe a Roaring Twenties. Like, that would be exciting. And now I understand why everyone was going out and getting fucking dressed up for everything. You know what I mean? Like, they had just been through the Spanish flu. Like, you know what I mean? You know, everyone's like, it's the time of color and just going out for the sake of going out.
So we're
going
to have our Gatsby
moments? Yeah. Oh, man. That would be nice, wouldn't it?
Well, hopefully we don't hit what happened right after that, which is the Depression.
Yeah, that's true.
Let's ignore that part. Let's just stick to the Gatsbyan moments.
That's very true.
That's a great book. Have you ever read The Great Gatsby?
In school.
Yeah, I read it in school too, and then I reread it recently. It's such an interesting observation and critique, more of an outsider's view of the decadence of that time. Not so much an insider view, which I think I appreciated.
Yeah.
I think I was at
an age where I didn't really appreciate it when I read it.
Dude,
I spark noted.
I didn't read until
The
college.
Alchemist?
No, it's in our library. My wife's read it. I've seen it.
God,
I see the spine.
It's calling you, bro. That's one that's a powerful one.
How so?
Oh my God, man. I don't want to divulge any of the information of the book, but if you're in the works of creating and aspiring and dreaming, that book That'll get you. I wept like Meryl Streep at the end of that book. I'm telling you, man.
Isn't that the best when art takes you to tears? Isn't that the best?
It's the best. Yeah, it makes you feel something. I think that was the Jimmy V speech. You ever see the Jimmy V speech? It says you do three things in a day, you have a
Jimmy,
full
the
life.
Jimmy, the basketball coach?
Yeah, the ESPN speech.
No.
Oh, he did. You probably know. You do three things in a day, you'll have a great day. I think you said, I don't want to miss it. But I do remember two of them, and one was laugh, and the other was cry.
I got to work on that. I got to work on the crying. I don't get to do it enough, I don't think. I think like many guys, and maybe it's like an Italian thing too. I don't even know, but it's just like.
We're emotional though, Italians.
Extremely emotional, but when it comes to certain emotions, it's like you better push that shit down.
Yeah, that's very true.
Oh, here
yeah.
it comes. Push that shit down. And when it does come out, you're like a baby.
Yeah.
You got like no control. Yeah. Flapping arms the whole bit.
Yeah.
I could use a few more releases. I could use some help with that.
Yeah, but it's a powerful speech. You ever try meditation?
I've dabbled, but have not gotten to the states that I should.
There's a practice called Transcendental Meditation.
TM, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm familiar with it.
I'm trained. I did the class, the initiation, all of it.
My buddy did about 2 years ago. And then what? Then you just have to sort of, maybe just then on a monthly basis, you create your own practice.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And
there's
you create your own mantra. It's a personalized...
No. Well, it's given to you.
Oh.
Yeah, it's given. It's.
I do know
lie.
You can't divulge it.
Yeah, you can't. It's
I know
weird.
A little bit about that.
Yeah, you do. Yeah,
so
yeah.
Tell the people about TM a little bit.
TM, I watched. I'm like a YouTube junkie, man. I'm like you've never met anyone like
it's
me.
It's easy to go down a hole.
I've seen every studio session and every interview of everyone I like. Like it's crazy. But I saw a Howard Stern, Jerry Seinfeld interview there in a coffee shop. And Jerry was talking about TM, and he was saying how if it wasn't for that, he wouldn't have been able to do the show, Seinfeld, because he was a writer star. Think about the workload of that, you know what I mean? And TM, it's, I guess the best way to do it, it's the truest way to recharge your batteries of your body. And yeah, it's a really great tool to have. Yeah, but Howard Stern and him had an interview talking about it, and I was like, man, those are people I like.
Those are two of the heaviest hitters of all time,
right?
In media,
like, what Jerry Seinfeld, man. Oh. Are you a Seinfeld fan?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I ever went out of my way. I was never a TV person.
Really?
I'm a bit of a geek that way, but. It's like not knowing Mickey Mouse.
Yeah.
So I probably came to some of it a bit later than the average person. But
are you a movie person?
It's pretty. I was always just a space cadet.
That's awesome.
I was listening
man.
To music. I was trying to play music, and I lived in my head.
Yeah.
I struggled with like reading books, especially fiction, and watching shows because I was so in my head. It was hard to enter. A different story, so I struggled with that. So it would carry over to even just the sitcoms too. I don't know what that thing is, but that's a funny fucking show though.
Oh my god, so good!
It's Larry so David. Stupid and Great so writer. Funny at the same time.
It's so good. It's
yeah,
hysterical.
Larry David, he's the guy, right?
The guy, Curb. Man, you don't watch Curb.
I've seen it.
Oh, okay,
I've seen it.
Seen The Last Dance though.
Let's talk about. So we're both wearing basketball T-shirts. Which is pretty funny. I'm just a little shout out to Neptune, my hometown.
The man.
I noticed you had the Dennis Rodman T-shirt on, and that was the first thing I said to you.
Yeah, like, absolutely.
Did you see The Last Dance? Oh, and what did you tell me?
60 times over.
60 times.
I'm not
you
could have
stopped at 23 Michael. And kept it like.
Yeah. Oh, that would have been nice.
That would have been very nice.
Little, yeah.
If any of you haven't seen, it's Netflix.
It's on Netflix, right?
Netflix yeah. documentary, The Last Dance. It's a, I don't know, what do you call it, a miniseries, whatever, 10-part.
It's almost like a full series, yeah, it's 10 episodes, it's big.
On, I mean, broadly speaking, it's about Michael Jordan. Broadly speaking, it's about the Bulls' hot years in the 90s. But more broadly speaking, it's about process, and it's about work ethic. And I was surprised by how many people were surprised that Michael Jordan wasn't like this sweetheart of a. I'm like, really? You really think that guy is going to be the nicest guy in the world? Seriously. I mean, were you surprised by it? Like, of course.
Absolutely not.
Of course.
Man.
That first of all, he's not an asshole. He was just like, hey, if you're not working as hard as I am, fuck you.
Yeah. That was okay. Something he said. I remember he was like, I never asked someone to do what I didn't.
Of course. The tough part is being next to him. No one
could do
is as good or as hardworking or as focused or as driven. Apparently, ever.
Yeah, I don't think so. But there's no excuse to not work hard, though.
There's no excuse. So even those guys who are like, I can't say that I liked him much, but I can say I was a better basketball player for being on the team with him.
Exactly.
So all those guys are having like that moment.
Yeah.
Can you imagine, like, first of all, I would not want to be on his team. I don't know if I want to be next to the guy or gal who is the greatest of all time. It's almost like, hey, we're going to go to painting.
Daunting.
Yeah, we're going to go painting with Leonardo da Vinci. I'm like, maybe there's another class that has, you know, Michelangelo at least, but not Leonardo. Please, no. And it was a fascinating documentary. His work ethic. I was not surprised in the least. And that was the big conversation. Of course, people, I guess, just have to create controversy.
Yeah.
Like, really, that's going to be the guy who's like, it's okay. You're going to be all right. Really? How's that even possible?
Yeah, you can't be.
And he had no qualms about it. He had no apologies about it. And I just want everyone to work as hard as I do.
Yeah, oh,
good
true.
Luck. It's so good. What were some of your favorite parts of the documentary?
Oh my god!
There were so
everything.
Many good ones.
It just like everything was so good. Learning about the flu game, which was actually the stomach flu.
Amazing.
Oh my god! Like this is like movie like script. Like it's incredible. But I guess I would just watch him in there and just. You see in his eyes the hunger, you know what I mean? And it's inspiring. You could use it to inspire yourself. And I think that's the biggest thing about Mike is I think anybody who's watched him play or anything can't not be inspired by it. He was a giant.
I wasn't even a basketball fan really back in the day, but it's like, yeah, Jordan.
Neither was the world. He put the dream team. Like he turned it to icon. Like,
dude,
you know, even with the kicks, Jordan. Are you kidding me? Like, and then the whole thing, like saying like Nike was just a track shoe company at the time. They weren't even into. Really the big sneaker game. I think Reebok was...
They said Reebok and...
Adidas
were the big players
who Mike
in
wanted
the
to
game.
Go with. And Mike didn't want to go on the plane to even go to Nike. Hearing that today, I'm wearing Nikes.
I had a pair of shorts.
Every day I wear Nikes. You're like, it's just... I mean, as a cultural impact, it's just uncanny. It's, but mainly, I would watch it just to see what it takes, like, you know what I mean? To they do a really good job of giving you a glimpse of what it took to be great, because it's an uncomfortable process. There's no doubt about it, and I think they do a good job of showing that it was not that he was really handed it by any stretch. He went and got every single bit of it by himself. I mean, obviously the big story cut from the high school team comes home, you know what I mean? Even I think his dad was saying at that time, he may not have even been the best basketball player in his house. I think
his brother was Larry. Yeah, his older brother had the edge on him. That's hysterical.
But I think he also credited that to his drive. Of saying I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for those blows with my brother.
Well, there's no argument that failure is one of the biggest motivators that the universe can hand you.
It's true.
And, you know, there's obviously various ways to deal with failure, and we all have various tools in our toolbox to deal with failure. But just from a spiritual standpoint, a mental standpoint, most of us have that within us. And how do you deal with that? And the way he dealt with it was just incredible. And I tell you, you know, we were joking about how everyone was surprised that he was such a hard ass and not a friendly guy, but his humanity shined through, I thought, in the most interesting way with the dude you have on your t-shirt.
Absolutely.
And I didn't get a feeling he was just talking shit or just saying it after the fact. His sort of compassion for someone like Rodman, who was like almost like had like a bipolar sort of experience, where he was like clearly one of the hardest workers on the team, one of the most naturally talented defensemen in the game, and then was like, well, I need to go bug out and party and drink and fuck and do drugs for a couple days, which is the antithesis of like a professional athlete's well, maybe not the antithesis, but when you're thinking about dynasty teams and you're looking at Michael Jordan as like, okay, that's the archetype for this. And Mike's sort of compassion with that, and like, yeah, all right, maybe. What did he say to the coach? He's like, you know, if you let him go for 2 days, he's not coming back.
Yeah. He's like, you let him out the door, he ain't coming back.
And he had to go get him at the hotel. He had to pull him out of Vegas. Story.
Yeah, that really was the best story. But credit to Phil Jackson, man. Like, talk about another person that's just, like, iconic.
He was a big star in that documentary. Quiet star, but, like, you know, just talking about his mindset and his spirituality.
Yeah, that was really,
meditation.
I didn't know much about him. Admittedly, I didn't know about his Native American heritage or even his way to becoming the coach of the Bulls. But yeah, like, for him to be like, yeah, all right, like, to accept him as a person, he knew that he was bringing all, like, when it came to the end of it, he was going to bring the best out of him. Instead of saying, no, you're not going to Vegas, we're in the middle of a playoff run. You know what I mean? And he was saying, all right, you got to do this. It looked like he treated them as people before players.
Which is incredible, because there's incredible. No more pressure position, I assume, than being a professional athlete. It's akin to, I guess, being a big-time actor in a big film or a big musician on a big tour. Everyone is putting all the pressure on you. And to have the confidence, it showed a lot of confidence in Phil Jackson in himself, his decisions, in his team. And I guess in the universe, too. It was pretty spiritual.
Yeah, it was.
And to see, like, Rodman juxtaposed with Jordan, yet they appeared to, like, really have a nice vibe.
Yeah. I think Scotty was like, how did Dennis fit? He was like a hand in a glove. Right in.
Yeah, Scotty Pippen.
The man. He's, like, also one of my favorites. I mean, even just that whole documentary, like, Steve Kerr, what a story. I didn't know about his father. I didn't know any of that.
Oh, Michael Jordan's father. I had forgotten.
Michael's father, but also Steve Kerr's father.
Oh, I don't remember this.
He was like an American diplomat and got assassinated overseas. I forget which country.
I forgot about
butcher
that.
It. Something is a Stan. So I had no idea about that. And then to think that was really something that Michael and Steve Kerr had in common, you know, at that point when they were playing together. Of course, Michael's...
I didn't know that story until the documentary, and I had forgotten that Michael Jordan's father was killed. It's interesting.
It is. But nonetheless, they did such a good job with that. It was so good. It was incredible. It was so inspiring. Just made you want to go do something, you know? It made you want to get after it.
It totally did. That's when, like, a film will... You'll be like, okay! And you just get up and you
hell
go do your
right,
thing.
Man.
That's the best. I remember when I was really young and I saw The Karate Kid for the first time. I was like, we're doing some karate. That's it. We're doing this. And, you
did
know,
you do it?
Well, in my own way. Yeah. My parents were like, I'm not taking karate. Like, we had no money. I wasn't taking any lessons of any kind. They're like, go punch your pillow. You'll be all right.
Oh, man. Did you grow up with brothers?
I have an older brother. So there was four of us in my family, and my brother is about 3.5 years older than me. Growing up, we had nothing in common. We were as, like, I love seeing my boys now. I have 2 young boys, and they play. I mean, they fight like fucking animals.
Yeah, they
animals,
should, man.
But they adore each other. They get into it together. My brother and I, we didn't do anything together. We were like polar opposites. I told you, I lived in my head. I was a total space cadet. And like, oh, what about this? My brother, from the time he was like 5 or 6, he was setting up chairs in his room and putting like stuffed animals in them and like teaching them. He was like a teacher. And like scolding them. Like he was like, it's like the total opposite. But yeah, I mean, we loved each other, but we didn't really have a relationship until probably college. That's when we kind of broke through. We went to college in
the
same
city.
Was
there like a subject that you guys like during that time kind of was like, hey, yeah.
That we agreed on?
Yeah.
No, there was nothing.
Really?
There was nothing.
That's interesting.
I mean, it didn't seem weird because you don't know. I mean, when you're growing up, you only know the little bubble around your face.
That's true. Yeah.
I just wanted to like listen to music and fantasize about I don't know.
And play guitar, right?
I got into guitar pretty early.
Yeah,
but I was obsessing over
that.
Music even earlier than that.
Who was your like guitar heroes?
When I was skilled enough to hold one and play maybe a couple chords, the artists that I was like, oh, I gotta do it like that. It was probably Peter Buck of REM, Johnny Marr of the Smiths, Peter Buck too. I think those two guys, and I was surrounded by folk music and like Christian hymnal music, like church songs. So like that style of guitar playing, which is the way my mom and her band would play it, very tied into popular folk music and even now like popular rock music. It's like all the same chordings. So hearing the traditional aspect of it and getting a handle on it, and then hearing great bands like the Smiths and REM, this is like probably in the 80s, I would just try and make, I never took lessons or anything, but I would just try and, well, if I put my fingers like this, it sounds like,
yeah,
this.
It's before, well, YouTube.
Yeah, that sounds like shit. If I put my fingers like this, well, that sounds less shitty. How about like this? Oh, that's cool.
Really?
So it was the long path to learning. Eventually, I asked my mom to teach me. Finally, when I was just like, what am I doing? I asked my mom. And she's like, I'll show you what I know, but I'm mostly self-taught too. So I'll show you the few things I know. It'll get you by for a little while.
That's
longer.
Awesome.
So she taught me the couple little tools to keep in my kit.
That's really cool. I'm sure that those are great memories.
Oh, they're great. I'll still bust their chops. I'm like, come on, get your guitar out. No, my neck hurts. I'm like, you can sit down. You don't have to put on the strap. I got her, you know, years ago, I pointed her towards a super, super light Martin guitar. So
beautiful.
I'm like, your neck's going to be fine. So I'm always like.
A dreadnought? Or
no. I forget which shape it is. I don't remember. It probably is.
Mm. Are you a Clapton fan?
No.
Really?
No, I don't give a shit about Eric Clapton.
How?
Well, I don't think he's that interesting.
Oh, my God.
Sorry, world.
I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, blues music to me is a... I'm going to get fucking murdered. Blues music for me is a pretty confined form. And
my dad's a blues guitarist, so that's why the Clapton.
He's probably waiting for me outside right now with a fucking wrench. I think it's a bit of a confined form, and I think what especially artists like Eric Clapton and a lot of the British rockers were sort of copying was really an old black Southern American style of playing. If I'm going to listen to blues, I kind of like the really old
Robert
shit.
Robert Johnson, Muddy Waters, stuff like
that. That's where I'll go to. And I'm not, and it's not to say that blues, it can't be expressive. In fact, some great guitarists really blend some killer rock elements with blues. Matt O'Ree, a local guy. I mean, he's international on many levels, but he does it well.
John Mayer?
John Mayer does it all.
He does. He's a blues man.
Yeah, but he does it all.
He does it all, but he's...
He'll break your heart with a song. You start crying.
Yeah, I'm like, but...
I hate him. I love him so much, I hate him. But Eric Clapton, I just don't like.
I can't believe that.
Come on. You'll be all right.
Tears in Heaven. Layla.
I'm not saying they're not cool songs.
Yeah, I know.
I'm just saying.
The Allman Brothers.
Yeah, I like some Southern rock. I don't listen to it as much as many people, but... That like the guitar onslaught of those Southern rock bands, it's killer.
Yeah.
The amount of sound, amplified stringed instruments is killer.
Oh yeah.
And a lot of that music. How did you get turned on to a lot of that? Oh, your father.
My father. Yeah.
So your brother was into rap.
Yeah.
And your dad was like cranking some Clapton and.
Clapton, Supremes, anything Motown. I think Motown is my favorite music of like all time. But Stones, and then like Simon and Garfunkel, the Beatles, of course.
Of course.
Yeah, man. He showed me everything. He did. He made sure once I had the conversation of saying, "This is what I'm gonna do. This is what I'm supposed to be doing." He made sure to. One, make me understand what it takes to succeed, and two, the history of things. So he made it very important for me to know about just about everything before me.
I hear a lot of the R&B vibe in some of the tracks of your songs.
Yeah, especially the new record. I was playing it on the way here. It's very R&B.
When do you plan on completing that?
It's just about done.
Is there a release date?
No. I can't do that. I'm actually a little weary of doing that, too, until I have the final masters back.
No, it's smart.
Yeah.
Because with a lot of distributors, you think you know what's going to happen.
That's true. And also, I've also learned there's a whole boatload of things that you got to do before you release it. That I've learned. I think
educate the people, because I get a lot of artists in here who will pick their release date and pick some release show back when there were shows, and they don't even have their masters yet, and then they're like, you know what, I want to make a change.
Yeah, see,
to
that's
this mix, and you're like, okay, well, your timeline is fucked.
Yeah, that's tough. I
give
really
some lessons for some artists.
That's become a golden rule with me, only because I've made that mistake before, is preemptively putting a date. And thinking, you kind of think, like, this will give me the pressure to get it done by then. Nonsense.
That works in some things.
Some
but
things,
not
but
release.
Not when itself, because you could change it. There's no concrete. It's not, so, you know what I mean? No one could hold you to it. Yeah, so I've learned not to do that. But two, I've also learned that a fundamental thing, people can't like the music or dislike the music if they don't know about the music. So one of the most important things is getting it out, actually getting it out. That's of the part that I've learned is marketing and understanding that you in today's age, you need to do it all. You need to market yourself. You need to be doing everything. And especially for people, young artists, like, even there's a thing that happens is you release something and it maybe it doesn't get the initial traffic or whatever you want to call it that you were hoping for. And you start to think it's because of the quality of the song. But it's probably not. It's probably because no one has the opportunity to see it. That's a very, very important part. It's a very hard thing to do too, in an uninvading way, because nowadays with Instagram, the dreaded, oh my god, like I get 20 a day, the dreaded DM of, hey, I'm so and so from so and so, just released this, please check it out, give me your thing, which is like nice, but that doesn't work. That's
well,
not
for a guy, I mean, last I checked, you had close to 1 million streams on your tunes. Is that accurate?
Yeah, that's accurate.
Give some concrete advice to some artists out there. What what's worked for you and what should they be doing? Be specific, if you would.
What's worked for me is...
Because you're absolutely right. You can't just, like, put something out and be like...
My job is done. No, the job starts after
it's lame. Put out. That's super lazy and lame.
Yeah, but it's not... It's no one's fault because as an... You think maybe not, but if I were to do that, one is if you're really trying to get bang for your buck, singles in the beginning, absolutely. And I learned that because I did 3 LPs before I did singles. Actually, like all those records that are really old for me now, in terms of like that I have a whole brand new record already. That was initially an album.
Oh. And you broke it up.
I broke it up because I was like, man, I got to change something. I've done 3 CDs. I've released them all at once. You know what I mean? Just here. Here's 12 tracks. Here's 16. Here's 15 in an interlude. You know what I mean? But the way people consume music nowadays, and especially for new artists, that's not the bang for your buck. And I've learned that by research and talking to people here too, and talking to John too. John gave me a lot of great tips and a lot of great insight. But learning that if you're first releasing stuff, I think singles is almost 100% the way to go.
And that doesn't mean, by the way, that you have to record one at a time.
Yeah, no,
I'll
not
often
at all.
Recommend to artists, you might want to record a full album or 5, 6, 7 songs. By the way, it's going to be cheaper. It's going to be more cost effective
Very
to record
true.
More. But that doesn't mean you have to release them all at the
Very
same
true.
Time and then make a plan. What's your release plan? What's like a satisfying interval that's worked for you?
In terms of what?
Time
since
length
creation
between,
to release?
Between releases.
So that is, I think, discretionary, like up to anyone to decide. But like I said, that those 6 records or 7 records I had was an album. It was like along with 4 other ones that I'm gonna release probably in the next month, just to do a little drop. But I think what I've learned is that it's easier for someone to come across one song than it is an album for some reason. It's easier for someone to digest. It's not, here's 3 courses at once. And that is a good thing, though, when you're in a certain position. But when you're first, really, you'll get bang for your buck by doing one song at a time, something easy to digest, and following it up with another one. And then after you have those, like, 3, 4, 5, whatever it is, to do give them their due diligence of pushing them. Don't, because a lot of times, us artists, and I'm sure you do, there's this thing that happens where you release something, and like you said, you think, all right, I'm done. You know what I mean? I put my feet up, watch what happens. It is so not that. You gotta work. You gotta hustle that thing. And through my method was... like Instagram marketing and learning how to market through social media. And I think I started like feeling a click, because it doesn't click right away sometimes all the time, but I think I started feeling traffic happen when I really was just pushing one song. I was pushing Sweet for a little. I was pushing Afternoons for a little. I was pushing Die King for a little. I did them all as their own thing and just pushed them by themselves.
All through traditional,
because nowadays...
Social media marketing.
Yeah, nowadays...
So pump $50 into this thing, $150 into
that
thing.
But in a strategic way, and I won't, of course, say like everything, but... yeah, to do that, to make content, to make, because this is the age of content, like we both know. You got to make content, whether that be video, you doing a beat, video of the cover art, with just audio, just anything that could come up a lot, you know what I mean? And I think that was a very important thing, but it was super hard, man. Because I was at a point where I was also, I didn't like any of the cover art people was doing for me. So I made all those cover arts. I made all of that. I did that all myself.
They look good. Thanks. I like your artwork.
Well, so I had linked with a guy named 69 Pixels, and I told him, I was like, hey, I love this like pixelated look. I think it's smooth. I like, you know what I mean? And I think that's like what I kind of want to do. And then I just told him what I envisioned, and we kind of merged that into the covers that are out today. But yeah, if I had to give one token of anything, is say pick one song that your friends love, and really push it, and not push it in a spammy way, because it's easy to do that too. You don't want to be the guy putting a comment on everyone's stuff or DMing like those horrible DMs. You know what I mean?
Just so, jumping in on every thread. Hey,
that's tough. That's not gonna
so
work.
Annoying. It's like streaking across the field.
But I understand because they don't know. Yeah. You don't know what to do. It's the Wild West. You don't know what to do. So I think it's just about finding a way to get it in front of people, and from them that they will tell you if it's worth for them. And that was kind of how I approached things.
For you, when you said to take into account, you know, what song your friends like, are you usually in line with the closest people to you? Like, I think this is the best track. Is there usually alignment between what your inner circle likes and what you like?
Most of the time. There's definitely times where I like songs and I'll get the look like it. or just basically like that. I like this one better. You know, it's also a funny thing. I think John Mayer even said it. It's sometimes always the case where the song you don't think is the song or whatever ends up being the song. It's a funny thing how that happens. I'm sure you've had instances like that. You 100%. Know what I mean?
I think anybody who's created anything is, if you have enough output, at some point you get surprised, and that's cool.
Yeah,
it's fun to get surprised in that way.
It is, right?
What can you tell us about the new record, without giving away? You know, I know you keep things guarded generally, and yeah, I respect that about you. But what can you tell us about the new music that you have coming?
I am gonna do a CD with singles, and it's got some cool features on it that are really, really cool, really exciting to have, and self-produced. I produced every beat on the thing, and I wrote every word on the thing. And right now, it's my baby. Right now, I've been working it for a minute now. So, just waiting for all the things to align. Basically, see, I'm still even learning about things of playlisting and other things, and there's like taste curators where you're really supposed to submit these things to these people before you release it, and they kind of go through it and see if you get on this playlist, if you get on that playlist, which has also become a huge scam. Like, that's like now we're in a little bit of a steroid era of music.
100%.
Because it's tough, because you got people that'll just pay to be on a playlist. Like, hey, that's not what I'm talking about. They're like, Spotify has a thing where it's actual Spotify playlist curators, where if you set a release date in the future, it's submitted to them for their consideration. But there's other people, man, this is also one of the most disappointing things. There are so many people that take advantage of artists. Like, there are so many people that sell the dream of, hey, you want to be placed on this record, you want a beat placement on this, or I'm running a campaign. That's the word now. that's the word that's been used, a Spotify campaign, or, you know what I mean? And that's disgusting stuff to me, because it's preying on people that are hopeful.
Well, there's nothing new with that. I mean, that's got a long history of money preying on people.
Yeah, I'm curious how it was back in the day, like when CDs were the move. You know, like what kind of scamming was going on then?
There's always somebody who's trying to capitalize on your dreams. That's for sure. Because artists are generally hungry, are generally vulnerable in some ways, because you have to reach a space when you're writing and to put yourself out there. Also, sometimes a little utopian in their view, because again, you have That's to be if you're going to create art. I think you can't be so drilled down to reality, and that's a hot spot for some nasty people to come in and try and take advantage.
It's disappointing,
but advertisers, and they've been doing that forever, and I think it's just, it's important to stay intelligent. If something seems better than it is, it probably is. And nothing's going to replace grinding, working hard, and putting something out there. The second you finish something, get started on the next damn thing. Like, there's no, I made it. Like,
any successful
person, none of them talk about making it. They just continuing.
Yeah, that's also just a 360 back to The Last Dance. I think Phil Jackson said, you're not a success, you're only a success when you're performing a successful act. So no matter what happened in the past, it doesn't matter. It's what you're doing right now, which is also a really good tip, because there's times where you could be like, not satisfied, but maybe not complacent either, but it just ease off the gas.
Like, especially if your ego's getting stroked a little bit. If you're feeling good and you have a few people gassing you up, it's like, That's a very nice place to be. It's very comfortable. I can think about a few times when I was younger. Those were always the times that I eased off the gas when I was getting gassed up.
That's a brilliant way to put it.
You got to catch yourself in those moments, though.
Very true.
Because history will show that you're going to be obliterated in nothing in moments.
Oh, yeah.
You got to work hard. There's no, and a lot of your lyrics on your songs, correct me if I'm wrong, but one of the heavy themes in a lot of your songs that you've released is working hard. It's about work ethic,
Exactly. Yeah.
Making people proud by your work ethic. I'm not saying this is your favorite line or the greatest line you've written, but sometimes in my head, I'm like, working all day, I need some Advil, and which is one of your lines.
That's just,
your line pops into my head sometimes.
That's just one of the most honest lines.
I'm not saying it's your high art moment. I'm just saying, but that's cool.
That's not quite my McCartney Lennon.
Sorry.
No, that's funny. Hey, whatever.
But those are the things that stick sometimes. Yeah. Isn't that funny? I mean, that's a line that sticks in my head. There's a lot of great artists.
I'm honored to be in your head.
When I'm in my kitchen and I'm like, I can't take it anymore, and I'm looking at the Advil, you're right there with me.
Oh, man. Always.
There's a really great artist, Tierra Whack.
Yeah, I had a chance to meet her.
Okay.
Her
music is off the charts.
Oh, my gosh. She's a great rapper.
I
just saw it. She was just recently doing Instagram videos where she was rapping.
Yeah, she was freestyling on
those
videos.
She was killing. But if you dissect the lines, because I'm like a Jay-Z person too. Like, if you ever listen to Jay-Z, there's two levels to what he's saying. The surface and underneath the surface.
Well, all the best writers. I mean, Bob Dylan. Et cetera. You could read three stories in one story.
So true.
Great poets. It's incredible, but like, she has all this amazing music, but like, what's the line that sticks? Again, in my kitchen with one of my kids, she's got this real quick little, it's just an outro, it's not even part of, it's like something about Mario and Luigi. It's like, and Luigi, and like, that's like that's the line that like my kids have, and we're scheduled to have, and I hope I don't ruin it by putting it out there in the universe, we're scheduled to have her manager and engineer in here on the show very soon.
Very cool.
Kenneth Sims. And I want to talk to him about that. Yeah. Like, you know, you guys do all this hard work, and then you got like some 6-year-old in my kitchen going, "And Luigi." That's what they get out of it.
Oh man, that's cool, man.
Dude, I really appreciate you coming on Through the Glass today, folks. If you haven't checked out Vero's music, please do so. It's just got some great songs. I mean, you could start with Sweet, but they're all good, and we look forward to some new material from you. Vero, thanks for coming on the
show. Always a pleasure to be here, man. And like I said, you and everyone here, this is just, to me, the greatest place on earth. You know what I mean? I love this place. I can't leave it. And I would just like to take a second to say something. I've watched all these episodes, and you have done a phenomenal job, man. Even with the name, with everything, with the branding. Me and Colin are just so proud of everything you're doing, and so excited to be a part of it.
That's our show, folks. Thanks, brother.
Of course, man.